China is now restoring the Great Wall. It will function similarly to the wall constructed many years ago, but they are no longer required to construct structures out of stones, mortar, sand, and debris in an effort to repel the hordes of the enemy. Trees are now used in construction. The world's largest man-made forest should prevent an adversary that China has been battling for many years. This enemy is much more serious than the overpopulation problem. Their enemy is the unceasingly expanding desert that covers the majority of eastern China. Despite having a size equivalent to the United States, only 12% of China's land is cultivable. Nevertheless, China continues to produce more food than any other country worldwide. All of the arable lands are intensively farmed, and the government has made significant investments in raising yields and protecting the region. Amazingly, such a populated nation was able to achieve food self-sufficiency. In Northwest Xinjiang region, self-sufficiency stunningly is on display. Despite the terrain being nearly entirely desert, people in Xinjiang can cultivate vegetables without rain by using drip irrigation and other modern evaporation-reducing technologies. What is the outcome? Numerous crops, including tomatoes, garlic, onions, watermelons, and melons, have gained a reputation on a global scale and can rival the flavor of fruits cultivated in southern Italy. Because every hectare of land is needed, desertification has become a serious problem. And because of its rapid expansion, it is undoubtedly one of China's most pressing environmental problems. And the sandy lands, which already occupy up to 27% of the country's surface, are expanding quickly. From 600 square miles in the 1950s, they were consuming arable land at a rate of about 1,000 square miles annually by 2006. The Gobi Desert is the most sneaky enemy. Over 382,102 square kilometers, it spreads across China and Mongolia and is one of the world's driest deserts. Frequently, sand and dust block roads and railroads, flooding fields and villages. Many thousands of tons of these substances wind up in Beijing and other cities, where they pose a major health risk to the locals. There is a need to construct a new Great Wall in China because desertification is estimated to cost the Chinese economy billions of dollars annually. This time, the color is green. In contrast to the 5,500-mile-long defense wall, built in the 8th century BC to divide the Celestial Empire from the Mongolian steppes, the Great Green Wall of China is the world's largest initiative to plant forests. Its objective is to establish a 2,796-mile-long green belt to prevent the Gobi Desert from spreading while lowering carbon dioxide emissions by millions of tons. If everything goes according to plan, China's forested area will rise from 5% to 15% of its entire geographical area by 2050. The nation made the decision to build shelter belts along the southern edge of China's four greatest sand dunes, eight deserts, and lowest plateau. This is due to the fact that the main Chinese deserts are found in the Celestial Empire's north, northeast, and northwest regions. Additionally, the effort is intended to safeguard the nation from desert expansion from the north. Similarly, another unofficial moniker emerged for the program, which roughly translates to Forest Protection of the Three Norths. Deng Ku is thought to have designed the Great Green Wall of China. The project was started by the Chinese quite quickly, and soon the country's major legislative body passed a law requiring every adult citizen over the age of 11 to plant three poplar, eucalyptus, or other arches every year as a contribution to the general good. In certain locations, the government rents private land to establish forests, while in others, villages are compensated to plant seedlings. Grown and sold by business owners, mature trees are harvested for lumber. All of this is said to have reduced poverty in many places while making some people extremely wealthy. Therefore, in recent decades, the government used capitalism to produce trees rather than depending on revolutionary fervor. The biggest environmental initiative in history uses a variety of replanting techniques. First, common local trees and grassy rows are planted. Rows of bushes that can withstand drought are planted along the second line. The strongest trees, like poplar, are then introduced. They are planted by various teams, and seeds are dropped from planes. Officials from China, including ministers, participate in the planting of trees, in addition to experts and volunteers. Each year, more than 500 million individuals participate in this honorable activity, planting billions of trees in the process. The project's current goal is to plant 100 billion trees by the year 2050. New technologies also contributed in their own ways. The Chinese now have the ability to plant trees online as well as in person. In designated places, donations are gathered and used for planting. Since the start of reforestation 50 years ago, the desert has finally stopped expanding. An area the size of Greece has been covered in trees to block the wind for the past 10 years on 13 million hectares. The northern forest area has grown from 5 to 13.5%, or an area the size of Western Europe, despite the fact that the plan has not yet been fully implemented. As a result, the Chinese were able to save the area from the desert, which spans an area the size of Italy. The forest has developed and the amount of rainfall has increased where the first trees were planted. Rainwater can be stored in the soil, and the streams are now receiving more runoff. There are now natural parks everywhere that were once arid and desolate, like the Seihanbang National Forest Park, which is the biggest draw in northern China. Critics of the initiative do exist though. Their primary criticisms of monoculture are focused on this practice. The majority of the time, a single type of tree was planted, making forests susceptible to epidemics. In actuality, many trees have been killed by plant diseases. Hurricanes in the winter of 2008 damaged 10% of the year's work, and one-fifth of the trees perished. China was urged by the World Bank to focus on the quality of tree species rather than quantity. A scandal regarding forests surfaced a few years ago. Large Chinese cities, notably Beijing, are known to experience smog issues, which worsen annually despite the government's best efforts. The wind typically clears the smog from the cities, but less frequently in recent years. It has been claimed that these new forest plantings have hampered the free flow of air, and as a result, cities' air stagnates and cannot be cleaned. Even Li Chunliang, the deputy head of the People's Republic of China's State Forestry Administration, was compelled to specifically deny this allegation. He asserted that trees can only stop air circulation at the ground surface. In any event, they have more advantages than disadvantages, not to mention their contribution to the fight against smog. Although this may not be the ideal strategy, we must not overlook the fact that China just planted more trees than the rest of the world put together. China is amazing. The largest artificial forest in the world right now is a green wall.